So today we will, for some, it's a rehearsal look at the Mohr circle and active and passive soil failure. But after that, we will start with new topics. So first, I will rehearse the Mohr circle. The Mohr circle is a, let's say, mathematical tool, a way of showing things concerning stresses and the relations between different stresses. And you probably got it in the first year with solid mechanics. People who did soil mechanics, they should have had it very often. But if you look at cutting processes, which we do in this course, you will often see Mohr circles, so you have to understand what they do, what you can do with them. We will not do 3D Mohr circles or 3D surfaces. We will just do it 2D, two-dimensional, so it's not too complicated. Well, if you consider a cylinder of soil, and on top you have a vertical stress and horizontally you have a horizontal stress. And in fact, the places where you have those two stresses, normal stresses, you don't have shear stresses. And that's one of the things. We call those stresses and also those directions principal stresses. So the stress, the surface where you only have a normal stress is called a principal stress. That's important because you will hear that word more often in the course. So you always have two principal stresses with two directions, in this case vertical and horizontal. They are always under 90 degrees with each other, and later you will also see why. But you should remember there's always 90 degrees between them. Now, in many, let's say, simple applications, you consider the vertical stress always as a principal stress because it's the gravity of this planet. It's just the weight of the soil which gives a vertical stress. This is not always necessary. In soil cutting, it often happens that the directions of those principal stresses are not horizontal and vertical, but it depends on, for example, the blade angle. It can also depend on the angle of internal friction. So the fact that you work with vertical and horizontal is mainly because normally you have gravity which forms one of the principal stresses. That also makes it easy because if gravity is one of the principal stresses, then it means the vertical stress is just the weight of the soil. So if you take a certain plane, a certain surface in the soil, and you know the amount of soil on top of it, and you know the weight of that amount, then that gives you the vertical stress. Yeah. So the vertical stress is often easy to calculate. Now, if we want to know what are the stresses on any plane, any surface under an angle alpha, we have to do some calculations. Well, so here we have vertical horizontal, and this is the plane under an angle alpha. Now, what I already told in the dredging introduction course, if you want to solve this, you have to consider that an equilibrium of stresses does not exist. You can never take the equilibrium of stresses. You can only take the equilibrium of forces. So you have to transform those stresses into forces. And in this case, that's not too complicated. So we can make a triangle with the vertical stress and the horizontal stress. And under the on the plane under an angle alpha, we have a sigma and a tau. For this tau, by the way, you do not yet know in which direction the tau is. It could be in the direction of the picture. It could also be in the opposite direction. But that does not matter, because if you do it in the opposite direction, you will get a minus sign in front of the tau, and at the end the result will still be correct. But one thing in general, you should have a good definition of what is a positive axis, what is a negative axis, what is positive, what is negative. And in soil, normally compression is positive and tensile is negative, while in mechanical engineering it's the other way around. In mechanical engineering, in steel, usually tensile is positive and compression is negative. Yeah? So you have to remember that. Okay, so if we look at this picture, you see all those four stresses. But like I said, you cannot take the equilibrium of stresses. You have to take the equilibrium of forces. Well, how do you go from stresses to forces? Very simple. You multiply the stress with the surface, with the cross-section or surface that it applies on. Now, in this case, you could say, yeah, but we don't know those the values for those surfaces, but you know the ratio of all those surfaces. So if we assume that this plane, so the plane under the angle alpha, has a surface of 1, yeah, just assume, and that means a length of 1 and perpendicular on the picture, you also assume a unit of length, so that's also a 1, then the sigma and the tau work on a surface of 1 square meter or whatever you want to call it. That means this one, the horizontal stress, works on a surface of sine alpha. And the vertical stress works on a surface of cosine alpha. Yeah, so the ratio between those three surfaces is 1 sine alpha and cosine alpha. That means, again, perpendicular on the blackboard, we assume a length of 1. So that means we know the ratio between the three surfaces, and you will see that if you would make those surfaces bigger, multiply it with some factor, then that factor will be in each force, and that means later in the equations you can divide by that factor and you will not see that factor anymore. So whether you just use the ratios or you use some actual surface, the result is the same. Yeah, it doesn't make a difference. Okay. Now, to solve this, and it's an exercise, and for some of you, you already saw this, but some didn't. It's an exercise that you also have to do when you want to solve problems of cutting processes, only in that case you have more angles, more parameters, so it's a little bit more complicated, but mainly because you have more terms in your equations. Yeah, but the principle is the same. So what do we do? First we take a vertical equilibrium, and in the vertical equilibrium you look at the vertical stress. Well, the vertical stress times cosine alpha gives you the force. So here this sigma v cosine alpha is the vertical force. Then on the other side we have the sigma times cosine alpha, which gives the vertical component, and because that surface is 1, you don't have to multiply with anything else because the surface was 1. So we get the sigma cosine alpha, and you can also see that in this case the tau works in that direction by the sine of alpha. So that's your vertical equilibrium. For the horizontal equilibrium it works the same. You take the sigma times sine alpha, and in this case the sine alpha is because of the surface. Yeah, the surface has the value of sine alpha, so you multiply with the sine alpha. So this is the horizontal force externally. And then you have a component of sigma sine alpha against it, yeah, opposite. But the tau works in the same direction as the sigma h, so it gets a minus sign, and you get tau cosine alpha. So this way, you have two equilibrium equations, and that means you can two equations with two unknowns, because the sigma and the tau are the two unknowns, and that means you can solve it. Yeah, if the number of unknowns and the number of equations is the same, you can always solve it. It's first year mathematics, basically. Okay, what do we do? Well, to solve it, let's say first we want to have an equation for the sigma. If you want to have an equation for the sigma, it means you have to get rid of the tau. You don't want the tau in your equation anymore. Well, how to deal with that? If you multiply the top equation by cosine alpha and the bottom equation by sine alpha, then in both equations you get such a term, but here I have a plus sign and here I have a minus sign, so if I add them up, I get rid of the tau. Yeah? So that's the way to do it. Well, it means I get here I get sigma v cosine squared, sigma cosine squared. In the second equation I get sigma h sine squared and sigma sine squared. If I add it up, I get the sigma v cosine squared plus sigma h sine squared equals sigma. That's the equation we get. Now, if you would continue with the alpha in the equation, you would never find the solution. So for the sine squared and the cosine squared, you have to substitute something, and that's basic mathematics, that for the cosine squared you can write 1 plus cosine 2 alpha divided by 2, and for the sine squared you can write 1 minus cosine 2 alpha divided by 2. Yeah, that's just basic mathematics. You substitute that in this equation, rewrite a little bit, yeah, reorder a little bit, and then you get the equation at the bottom. And in the equation at the bottom, you see you have two terms. You have a sigma phi plus sigma h divided by 2, which basically is the average of the two stresses. It's just the average, nothing else. And here you have the sigma phi minus sigma h divided by 2, which is the difference between the two stresses, the two principal stresses divided by 2. And later we will see that this difference divided by 2 is the radius of the Mohr circle. Here you see the cosine of 2 alpha, and that's also typical of the Mohr circle, that in working with Mohr circles, in the Mohr circle, all the angles are represented by 2 times the real angle. Yeah, we will see that when we see those circles. Okay, so this is the solution for the sigma. Then we want the solution for the tau. Well, if you want to have the tau, you have to get rid of the sigma. How to get rid of the sigma? Well, first of all, you want two terms that are equal, but with opposite sign. That means the top equation, which was the vertical equilibrium, we will multiply with sine alpha here, and the bottom equation, the horizontal equilibrium equation, we will multiply with minus cosine alpha, yeah, with the minus sign. You can also say I multiply with the plus sign and then I take the difference of the two equations, but if you multiply with the minus sign, you can just add up the two equations. It's easier to see which terms are equal but with a negative sign. So here you see they are equal but with a negative sign. So now if I add up the two equations, the sigma has gone, and I get this equation for the tau. Now, in general, if you find an equation with sine alpha cosine alpha or sine x cosine x, you know that basically it means I have the sine of 2x divided by 2. Yeah, that's also basic mathematics. So this equals the sine of 2 alpha divided by 2. And if I substitute that, then again, here I find the difference between the two principal stresses divided by 2, and I find the sine of 2 alpha, and that means I go to a system where every angle is 2 times the angle. Well, here we have those two equations, the sigma equation and the tau equation, and what I did with the sigma equation, I moved this term to the left-hand side of the equation, and then the reason is that by doing that I can do an operation that gives me the final result. But basically, those are still the same two equations. Well, now what I do is I square both equations, yeah? So I take the square of both equations and add them up. Well, if I do that, then this is the square of this term. This is the square of this term. This is the square of this term. Here you see the square of the tau equation, and if I add them up, then you will see that cosine squared plus sine squared is 1. So I get rid of those terms. And here I get the so-called circle equation. Why is it a circle equation? Well, basically, because in more circles, in general, we use a tau-sigma diagram where the sigma is the horizontal axis and the tau is the vertical axis. And that means here I have the horizontal coordinate minus the center of a circle. We don't know yet what it looks like, but it's the center of a circle. And this is the vertical component, so apparently in vertical direction I do not have any shift. In horizontal direction I have a shift, but in vertical direction I have not. And the right-hand side of the equation is the radius squared. Yeah, so if you look up the standard circle equation, you will see that this is almost exactly a circle equation. Okay, what does it look like? Well, to start with, we have the horizontal axis, which is the sigma axis. We have the vertical axis, which is the tau axis. We have the two principal stresses, sigma v in this point and sigma h in that point. And they are, like I said, they are always under 90 degrees because they are principal stresses, but since in the Mohr circle we multiply angles by 2, in the Mohr circle there's 180 degrees between the two principal stresses. And that means, and I also said principal stresses are on a surface where you don't have shear stresses, so they are always the two intersection points with the horizontal axis. Yeah, so if you draw a circle, you have the two intersection points. That's the two principal stresses, and then you always have 180 degrees between them. Whether you go in one direction or the other direction, it's always 180 degrees. So you can see the two alpha here. That means the point sigma comma tau is here. So if, for example, if that angle alpha would be 30 degrees, then in the Mohr circle here, I would see 60 degrees. If it would be 45 degrees, then in the Mohr circle, I would be at the top of the circle because it would be at 90 degrees. Yeah? So it's always 2 times the angle in reality. There's something more you can see. If we would have sand, and I will show you pictures of that later. If we would have sand, then you don't have what we call cohesion of or shear stress, and that means you always start in the origin. So we start with a sand-like material, it means you start in the origin. Then you can draw a line from the origin that is just a tangent at the circle. So we start here in the origin and the line just touches the circle, and then you will find a certain angle this angle, phi, and this angle we call the angle of internal friction of the material. But just mathematically or geometrically, this angle here will also be exactly phi. That has nothing to do with soil mechanics. If you make such a graph, just mathematically, those angles are equal. So here you have a phi, here you have a phi. You also have the negative axis, but very often we only look at the positive tau axis, although the negative axis also exists, because if you have a shear stress in one direction, there has to be a shear stress in the opposite direction on another plane, otherwise it's not in equilibrium. One important thing, you have an equilibrium. If you would not have an equilibrium of forces, which is possible, it means you have some force left, and that force will always result in accelerations. If there is no equilibrium, there is force left, you will have an acceleration. So if you observe from experiments that the material is not accelerating, that you have a nice steady state process, that means no accelerations, there has to be an equilibrium of forces. If you would have an experiment where you see accelerations, then you also know there is no equilibrium, right? So you have to think of that. An equilibrium is not something that you always have, but if I have a nice steady state cutting process and the material flows nicely over my blade without any accelerations, there has to be an equilibrium of forces. So this is just one picture. Well, if we know that this is the angle of internal friction, then okay, so if we can do a test, and I showed you the test last week, the triaxial test, you can do a test to determine this angle. But one of the problems of soil is that soil is never the same. Even if I take the same soil and I try to prepare it exactly as the previous time and I do the test again in the triaxial equipment, I will find a phi that's maybe 1 degrees or 2 degrees different. Because it's very difficult with soil to reproduce it 100%. That's also a problem with experiments in the laboratory, and I will show you that later. But if you take soil samples from practice, we call it situ, in situ samples, and you would test for this angle of internal friction, each spot can have different sand or clay or whatever. The particle size distribution could be a bit different, the density could be a bit different. So you will never find exactly the same angle of internal friction, and that also counts for the other soil mechanical parameters. So if you think of the permeability or the angle of external friction, all those things will never be exactly the same if you do another test. One thing we noticed is that if you do those tests, and as a company you want to build up a database of data about soils, and then you can say, oh, I already did a project in that area and now we do it again, so we probably have the same soil. If you want soil parameters that you can still compare, you have to do the test in the same laboratory, and if possible you let the same person do the test, because the outcome of the test could depend even on the person who is doing the test, on the whole preparation of the test. And so it's that critical. It's not that it differs, it will always differ too much, but 1 degree difference in the internal friction angle for a dredging company could mean 2 or 3% less or more production. So that's why they like to have everything carried out in the same way. Well, so what do we do? We take a number of samples and we do tests at different pressures. Here you can see a case, well, in fact, in this picture I took care that all the circles have a tangent at the same line, but in reality, for example, this circle could be a bit bigger, this one a bit smaller, and this one again a bit bigger. And then what you do is you try to draw the best fit line through those three circles, and then that's some average angle of internal friction. Yeah, so that's how you deal with that. And here you can see you have the sigma V1, V2, V3. So every time I increase the pressure, we call it the confining pressure, I increase the pressure, and that means my whole circle is shifting to the right. But you don't always have sand. You can also have clay or loam, and a typical thing of those kind of materials is they have strength. Sand does not really have strength of itself. So if I have loose sand, dry sand, and I want to shear it, I hardly need any force. Maybe I have to overcome a little bit gravity, but that's it. But if I have clay, I need a certain force because the clay has strength of itself. Now, this strength of clay follows from basically from two parameters. One parameter is the shear strength of the clay. So if I want to shear it, how much force or stress do I need to make it shear? And this shear stress we calculate at from the origin up, and then you take the intersection point on the vertical axis. In dredging we often talk about cohesion. In soil mechanics I think they call the SU value, or shear strength, I mean. But in dredging usually we talk about the cohesive soils. So this is the cohesion, and that also means the origin of those lines is somewhere on the negative axis. So that's one. So in fact, all I did to draw this picture is move the vertical axis to the right. Yeah, that's all I did. And then you get this intersection point. The second parameter, which is very important for us, and I don't think in normal civil engineering it's too important, but in dredging it is, it's the tensile strength of the material. So how hard can I pull on a piece of clay before it breaks? You can imagine if you build a dike and you use clay in the dike to make it isolate for water flow, the clay is always under compression, so I don't have to deal with the tensile strength. But when I'm dredging, when I'm cutting, and I'm kind of bending the material, you get tensile stresses in the material, and where you get them, you might get tensile failure. So the tensile strength is also important. Now, the tensile strength, in this case, you could say, is this point, is the point where those lines start. I could call that the tensile strength. But we will see later that on the negative axis, very often the shape of this line is not a straight line anymore, but it's curved and it goes to somewhere in the middle in this picture. Well, also in this case, you can do a number of tests, and based on the number of tests you can determine both the angle of internal friction and the cohesion of the material. Yeah, so in this case, because this intersection point, the cohesion, you use it in many equations, so if you just base it on one circle, it's not enough. And by the way, if you just have one circle, you don't even know whether it has cohesion or not, because if I have one circle, I can always draw a line from the origin with a tangent on that circle, And I would find a very high internal friction angle, which is not realistic, but yeah, any line is possible. So I really need at least two circles to find a combination of internal friction and cohesion. But in fact, the more circles I have, the more accurate I am. Active soil failure. It's one of the examples. So now we know the Mohr circle, we know how it works. Active soil failure, what do we have? Well, we assume we have a dam, but it could also be a bulldozer blade or whatever. Well, in the case of active soil failure, it's not a bulldozer blade, it's a dam. But with passive soil failure, it could be a bulldozer blade. So we assume the soil wants to fail by its own weight. And when the soil is failing, it wants to slide down. So what would be the force, the maximum force I have to apply on the dam to keep it stable, to keep it intact? And this is not just an imaginary example, because if you look at, for example, ports where you have the dams between the water and the land, there you always have to calculate how strong should the dam be to keep my quay, where the ships arrive, to keep it stable. So what do we have? Well, we have a normal force here and a shear force here. Between the two, we always have an angle phi, internal friction angle. In this case, we just consider sand, not clay. This is only sand. And further, we assume on the dam, we do not have friction. It's the most simple example of, you could say, a cutting process. Here you have an angle beta with the horizontal. In some books, you will find the angle beta here. Depends on the book, but we use the beta here. And you have a height h. Okay, so I want to know, what is the maximum force to keep it stable? Well, first I have to calculate the G, the total gravitational force, and the G, in fact, is the triangle of soil that wants to fail. So you have to calculate the cross-section of that triangle, and that's, I think, half cotangent B. Cotangent is 1 divided by the tangent. And you get the density of the soil times the G and the H squared, because it's a surface. So you get the H for one side and for the other side, but with some sines and cosines. So this is the equation for the G. The second equation we know is that in sand, we don't have cohesion. There's a relation between normal force and friction force, and the relation is that friction force is normal force times the friction coefficient. And in mechanical engineering, we always work with the friction coefficient, but in soil mechanics, they work with the internal friction angle, and the tangent of phi is equal to the friction coefficient. And so sometimes you use the angle, sometimes you use the friction coefficient. In fact, right now I'm working on some research with pipeline transport, the transport of sand and water in pipelines. And if the particles are too heavy, you will get a bed in the pipeline. But if the pressure is high enough, the bed will start sliding in the pipeline. And in all the publications, everybody talks about the friction coefficient and not about the friction angle. While many of those people who do that kind of research are civil engineers, but still they use the friction coefficient. So it depends on the topic. Once somebody starts with the friction coefficient, in all the publications you will see the friction coefficient. And that's the way it works. So we don't have cohesion, we don't have adhesion, and we have a smooth wall, meaning no friction on the wall. C is the cohesion in terms of shear strength, so it's not the force. The small c is the stress, the strength. The A is the adhesive strength, and the delta is the external friction angle. So between the soil and the dam. Well, we can write down the two equilibrium equations again. So we have the horizontal equilibrium and the vertical equilibrium. Just try to rehearse it at home. Well, and here you can see we want to know the F, but we also have the S and the N. So basically you have three unknowns, but we also have this equation as a third equation. Yeah, you have the F, the S and the N as unknowns. The G is your only known term, because it follows from the geometry. So basically 1, 2, 3 equations, so you can solve it. Well, the first thing you have to do is solve the F. That's at the top equation. We do that in the same way, by cross-multiplying the equations with a sine or a cosine, depending of from which term you want to get rid of. So this is the solution for the F. Then this was the G. We already derived that before. And if you substitute the G in the F equation, you get this equation. Now, what's not very nice of that equation, because we said we want to know where is the force at the maximum, because that would be the maximum pressure of the soil against the dam. When does that happen? Well, the only unknown we can still play with is the beta, is that angle. We already solved the other unknown, so we still have the beta as an unknown. But if you want to see at which beta is the F at a maximum or at a minimum, whatever you want, you take the derivative of an equation and you determine where is the derivative equal to zero. And if you want a maximum, then you also have to determine the double derivative, and the double derivative has to be negative. Yeah, that's mathematics again. But now the problem is, here you have the beta in the numerator and in the denominator. So if you start determining the derivative, you get a very complicated equation. Well, we can simplify it to this equation, and on the next slide I will show you how to do that. So first of all, this was the F equation. We need the derivative to be zero and the double derivative to be negative. Now that term, that complicated term, if you look at it, this was the term. Okay, I can say I take that term minus 1 plus 1, which just means I add 0. That's all. Well, you can always add 0 to something, it doesn't change. Then for the minus 1, I can write this denominator divided by the denominator. Yeah, then it's still 1. Well, except if one of the terms would be 0, then officially you can't do that, but we do not assume that's the case. So I have minus this term, plus 1. And I can also see here I have cosine times sine, here I have sine times cosine, and if I see such two terms, yeah, like sine alpha cosine beta plus sine beta cosine alpha, basically that's what I have, then I can add up the two angles and get one term. Well, if I add up the two angles, one angle is beta and the other angle is phi minus beta, so if I add them up, the result is phi. Yeah, phi minus beta plus beta is phi. So the result is just the sine of phi. So this term results in this term. This way I also get rid of the minus sign that I had in front of the equation, and the result is an equation where I only have the beta in this denominator. Okay, we go back to this slide. So that was this equation. Yeah. So I only have the beta in the denominator. I want to know the maximum. So when do I have the maximum F? if this denominator is at the maximum, because I have to deduct this term from 1. So if this denominator is at the maximum, this term as a whole is the smallest, which will result in the maximum f. Yeah, so I can just say, okay, so if I want to know the maximum of this denominator, all I have to do is take the derivative of that, just that one term, and then I also find the solution for the whole equation. So I take this term here, and f is at the maximum is the if the small f is at the maximum. Yeah, so that's what I do. Well, that gives me the solution for the derivative according to this, the cosine of 2 beta minus phi. This is the double derivative, and the first derivative is 0 when beta is pi divided by 4 plus half phi. And that's one of the standard solutions in soil mechanics. You will find these solutions in many applications. Well, we also substitute this angle in this equation for the double derivative, and we will find that the result is minus 2, which is negative, which means we are at the maximum. Yeah, you can also make a graph of the function, and you will also see its maximum. But at the time when people started with this, they didn't have computers, so they didn't have Excel and make a quick chart of such a function, which you can do now. And then you will see on the chart, on the graph, where is the maximum. But in those days, they had to do everything analytically. They didn't have those computers, and so they use this kind of mathematics. Okay, if you substitute this in the original F equation, this is the result. And we see, well, the first part is in fact from the G term, just from the weight. But between brackets we get a 1 minus sine phi divided by 1 plus sine phi. And this term we also call the coefficient of active soil failure. To give a feeling, what are we talking about? Well, if the phi would be 30 degrees, then the sine of phi is 0.5. So you get 1 minus 0.5 divided by 1 plus 0.5 is 1 divided by 3. Yeah, so that gives you a ratio of 1 divided by 3. Going a little bit further, we can also see that the relation between the horizontal stress and the vertical stress is also this Ka, which means the horizontal stress normally is just 1/3 of the vertical stress. So if I just go outside and I would measure in the soil, vertically I would measure the weight of the soil, and horizontally I would measure maximum, no, not maximum, something around 1/3 of the vertical stress, so of the weight of the soil. Yeah, so that's active soil failure. We will have a break, and after the break we continue. Even kijken, doet hij het? Ja, hij doet het. Okay, what does it look like, the active failure? So you get a Mohr circle. The biggest stress is the vertical stress, and the smallest stress, the horizontal stress, and here you have the internal friction angle. In soil mechanics, they call this active soil failure because the soil takes action. Yeah, so if the soil takes action, it's considered to be active. And from the point of view of soil mechanics, it makes sense. But from the point of view of normal thinking, you would say, well, if we take action, that's active, and if we don't take action, it's passive. But in soil mechanics, it's just reversed. Passive soil failure, that's the other way around. So active soil failure was when the soil takes action. Passive soil failure is when the outside world is doing something. So you could say that designing soil structures like dikes and roads and whatever is based on active soil failure. Passive soil failure is when the outside world is doing something, so that is what we do in dredging. In soil mechanics and civil engineering, you want to build something that stays there for 100 years, and in dredging, we want to destroy it in a fraction of a second. What is the difference? Well, the picture is almost the same. We still have the G and the F and the N and the S, but now the S is in the opposite direction. Why? Because the shear force is always opposite to the direction of velocity. So if we push so hard that we make the soil fail, we will push the soil upwards. Yeah, so it will move upwards in this direction. And that means the shear force is opposite, is downwards. And in active soil failure, when the soil fails, it wants to move downwards, so the force is upwards. So the picture is almost the same. The equations are also almost the same. We have the same equation for the weight, for the G. The difference is that we will find another beta. But the equation is exactly the same because it's the cross-section of a triangle, and that's a standard equation. We also have the equation between shear force and normal force. No cohesion, no adhesion, and a smooth wall, because we want to compare the two failure mechanisms. Horizontal and vertical force, and if you would compare the two, the equations of active soil failure with passive soil failure, you will see that somewhere you have a minus sign and here a plus sign, and in the other equations it was just the opposite. And that's because the shear force is in the opposite direction. Well, what do? We solve it. We get this equation for the F. The difference, again, with the previous case is that now we have a plus sign in the equation, and we had a minus sign. The G equation is the same, so if we substitute the G equation in the F, we get this equation. Now, we want to know a minimum, because we want to know the minimum force to make the soil fail, not a maximum. Because if I have a bulldozer and I'm pushing against the soil, at the minimum force where it can fail, it will fail. Yeah, so we are looking for a minimum. So again, we need the derivative. The double derivative should be bigger than zero now, because we are looking for a minimum. And we have to simplify the equation again to find the derivative. Well, how do we do that? Almost the same way. You have that term with the betas in numerator and denominator. You do minus 1 plus 1, so you add 0. Now, for the minus 1, you take the denominator both as a numerator and a denominator, then this is still 1. And now, again, we see a cosine, sine, sine, cosine, so we can put it together to one sine. The only problem is here you have a minus sign, and the first term has a plus sign, so you cannot just add up the two, but you can solve that problem by making this a plus sign by putting a minus sign for this beta. Because the sine of minus beta is minus the sine of beta. Yeah? So you are allowed to do that. Here, you also do that, and since the cosine of beta equals the cosine of minus beta, for the cosine, it doesn't matter whether you change the sine of the argument. So you can just do that. Okay, so now I can add up the two angles. So I have a phi plus beta minus beta, gives me the phi again, and the result is 1 plus the sine of phi divided by the denominator. Yeah, so that's the way to do it. I noticed once you know this, it's very simple, but I noticed in other lectures that most students will not think of this way of solving this problem. But once you know it mathematically, it's not very complicated. Okay, so we got this solution. And if we analyze the solution, we are looking for a minimum. So when is this term at a minimum? Well, since here is a plus sign, when the denominator here is at the maximum, the whole term will be at a minimum. So I want to know the maximum of the denominator. And that means I have to take the derivative, and the double derivative has to be negative again, because now I'm looking for the maximum of that denominator. Well, what do we get? This is the first derivative, second derivative. I will get zero for a beta of pi fourth, so 45 degrees, minus half the friction angle. And if I substitute that in the double derivative, I will find a minus 2, which is negative, so I found the maximum of that term. So it matches. I substitute the solution for beta in my equation, and this is the result. And now you see it looks almost the same, only in the case of passive soil failure, I will find 1 plus sine phi divided by minus sine phi. While in the previous case we had the minus here and the plus here. So it's just a matter of changing the pluses and minuses. That also means that if we look at just an example, 30 degrees, we get 1 plus 0.5 divided by 1 minus 0.5 gives you 3. And if we consider the relation between horizontal stress and vertical stress, in this case, it would mean the horizontal stress is 3 times the vertical stress. So if you compare it with active failure, it means it's 9 times as big, the horizontal stress, than in the case of active failure. Yeah. Yeah. Why is that? Because here we are looking at the derivative and double derivative of the F, of the force. And we need the minimum force. So for the minimum force, the double derivative has to be positive. And for a minimum, it should be positive. But now we simplify the equation to this equation, and here we want the maximum of the denominator. So now we are looking for a maximum again. And that means we need for a negative double derivative. Yeah? Okay. Okay, so this was the result. And what does it look like? Well, now you get the horizontal stress as the maximum principal stress and the vertical stress as the smallest principal stress. When can you get this? Well, already the example of a bulldozer pushing against the soil, that could be a possibility. Another possibility is what we call bridge forming. And bridge forming is, for example, you have a silo. A silo normally is a huge cylinder with a cone at the bottom, and material should flow out. They often use that in the ports to store whatever kind of material. And if you need some of that material, you open the silo at the bottom and the material should flow out. But it is possible that the material in the silo starts pushing against the wall because of gravity in the beginning. And it changes from active mode, where the vertical stress is the biggest, to passive mode, where the horizontal stress becomes the biggest. And in such a case, the horizontal stresses can become so big that actually there's a bridge in the silo, which is stable, and then if you open the silo at the bottom, nothing will flow out because the bridge is stable. And you need to do something to make it collapse. Well, if you look at a hopper dredge, when you empty a hopper dredge by opening the bottom doors or valves, and the hopper is full of sand, you could also get bridge forming in the hopper. Yeah, and then you can open whatever you want, but nothing will happen. So in the bottom of a hopper dredge, they have a lot of water jets to fluidize the sand, and this way destroy any bridge that might occur. And because if they wouldn't do that, you could get a bridge, yeah, and the hopper will stay full. Nothing will happen. So that's one of the dangers. Another case where you may have passive mode in nature is if you look at soils that used to have an ice cap on top of them in the Ice Age. Because during the Ice Age, also in the north of Holland, we had maybe 1 kilometer of ice on the soil. And because of that, the stresses in the soil became much larger than just by soil weight. Well, once the ice started melting, those large stresses stay in the soil, and you may get a passive mode of soil failure, which means if you go to the North Sea, to certain locations, you will find that the horizontal stresses are still bigger than the vertical stresses. And if you are a dredging company and you don't know, it means the cutting forces will probably be bigger and you need more power to dig the material. Yeah, and if you don't know that, and they say, oh, we have this kind of soil, and you think, okay, I can have a production of so and so much. And then once you start dredging, you find out the production is much less because the stresses in the soil were higher. Those things actually occur. Well, here you can see in the Mohr circles, active and passive. So if we have a certain vertical stress because of the weight, the small circle is the active case, so the horizontal stress in the case of 30 degrees, the horizontal stress would be one-third. And this is the passive case where the horizontal stress would be 3 times. And when we are cutting soil, we always have to deal with the passive case. This is the same picture, but then shift it a little bit and you get cohesion. Yeah, so you have an intersection with the vertical axis. So you have some cohesion. Cutting mechanisms. Well, I made some slides of a publication of the 60s of two Japanese who did some good research, but their research was focused on, I wouldn't say dry soil, but soil above water level. Yeah, but if the soil is above water level, it doesn't always mean it's dry. Sand could be dry, but normal soil will not be 100% dry. So in their paper, they mentioned certain equipment, and they wanted to be able to calculate cutting forces. This is a laboratory system they had. In fact, in reality, this looks like it's manual, but in reality, there's a motor driving it. But what you can see is here a blade, in this case under 60 degrees, and they put a grid in the soil, so you can actually see what is the soil doing, how is it deforming. And I must say, it's an old publication, but it's still one of the publications that gives you a nice overview of what is soil actually doing. Well, they have some examples. This is dry quartz sand. Now, normally when we talk about sand, it's quartz. So for me, this is just normal sand. You see the blade here, 60 degrees, and you see how it's deforming with it's shearing here, but it's not staying intact. Yeah, above the blade, you can see many cracks and shear lines, and that's what it looks like. Wet quartz sand, it also shows the shear plane, and yeah, a little bit the same, but it looks more compact. And the reason for that is that we will see later when you have wet sand, you get pore pressures because of the water, and the pore pressures keep the sand more together. Yeah, in dry sand, well, you could say I have air, but the air can flow so easily through the sand that we hardly have pore pressures. Plastic bentonite. Bentonite is a sort of artificial clay. They use it a lot in oil drilling. Yeah, you can see here you have some sort of plastic deformation, but you can see shear planes, and it is disintegrating. Then plastic loam. For me, plastic loam is also a sort of clay, but the chemical composition is a little bit different. But what do you see with plastic loam? You see plastic deformation, and the material stays intact. Yeah, you don't see all those cracks. It stays one flow of material. Sometimes that's good, sometimes that's not good. It depends on the application. Why would it not be good? Well, it flows nicely in one flow, but it's so plastic and so adhesive that if you have a cutter dredge, it will stick to everything where it can stick. And then if you have a continuous flow, once it sticks somewhere, the following clay will also stick. And before you know it, the whole cutter head is blocked with clay. You have to move up the ladder of the cutter dredge, remove everything and start all over again. So for a cutting perspective, we don't really like it, because this kind of process will block everything. Plastic clay, same kind of behavior. Plastic deformation, yeah, so you have shear planes, it is shearing, but it is not failing. Yeah, in other materials it's actually failing, so if you have a shear plane, it cracks on the shear plane, but in those kind of materials it's a continuous process. This looks a little bit like steel cutting on a turning machine. You get a continuous curl, and you have to put we call it breakers. So on the turning machine you have a special piece of metal to make the curl break, because also when you are turning steel, you don't want this continuous curl, because it can stick to everything, not like clay, but it can get into the machine, and you don't want that. Compacted loam. So compacted loam you can compare with very hard clay, very dry hard clay, and you see that here you get cracks. And in fact, why do you get cracks? Well, you can consider this cutting process as bending the material. And if you are bending material, whatever material it is, on the outside you will get tensile stresses, and on the inside you get compaction. And if those tensile stresses at the bottom exceed the tensile strength, you will get cracks. And that's actually what is happening here. This is a summary of what you just saw. So this is what could happen if you have shear failure, but plastic shear failure. This is what happens in sand. So they call this the shear type. This is the flow type, where you just have one shear plane, but also plastic deformation. So we call it the flow type. And this is what happens if you get those tensile cracks in very hard loam. And normally you can calculate under which angle the shear crack, the tensile crack will occur. And then after a short while, after the first crack occurs, you get a secondary crack. So this we call the primary crack. Then you get a secondary crack under 90 degrees. Because if you would put the process in the Mohr circle, you see it's at 180 degrees with the first crack. So that's why you get exactly 90 degrees for the secondary crack, theoretically. But that's what those guys found. They also, in their publication, They show some more diagrams. Well, here you don't see the circles, but those are all sigma tau diagrams. So this is for dry quartz sand. Plastic bentonite, you can see that the angle of internal friction is very small, so it's almost horizontal. And here they put a point, which is the tensile strength. So we will not look at the intersection point with the horizontal axis, but you measure the tensile strength, and that basically that means that those pieces of the line should not be there. We should cut the lines there and draw a vertical line here. This was plastic bentonite. Plastic loam looks a little bit the same. Here you have plastic clay, and you can see the tensile strength is much further away, and that means relatively my tensile strength is much larger. So if I am bending that type of clay, I will still get those tensile stresses, but the tensile strength is bigger than the stresses, so I will not get a crack. This is the compacted loam, and you can see the tensile strength is very small compared to the other stresses, and that's why I will exceed this point and I get tensile cracks. This is another summary where they say, okay, this is the shear type. Here we have the flow type. So shear type is in sand, it will fail on the line under the angle of phi. Yeah, we call it a failure criteria or failure line. This is what happens in that plastic bentonite, so it will fail on this line, not on tensile strength. Plastic loam, the flow type, will also fail on this line, but now it's not destructive, and with that I mean if you really get a shear plane and it's shearing and it's like a fracture, that's what I call destructive, because yeah, after that the two pieces of material are not connected anymore. So that's actually what happens here. But in the flow type, you only get plastic deformation, which means after cutting, it's still intact and it still has its strength. And then here, the tear type, it fails on the tensile strength. So not on this line, but it will fail on the tensile strength. In rock, we are not considering rock here, but in rock, usually you have a rather complicated cutting process where a number of those failure mechanisms occur at the same time, and that makes it more complicated. This shows you a little bit about the two principal stresses. So we had the maximum and the minimum principal stress, and here they show the lines of minimum principal stresses, and in this direction the lines of maximum principal stresses. And that means in this area you will get the tensile stresses. Well, that's what you can see over here. This area B is the area where you have tensile stresses. In this area, usually you have compressive stresses, and here they show the corresponding Mohr circles, so you can actually see what does it look like in the Mohr circle. Here you see it again, high tensile strength, I will get the flow type. Sand has no tensile strength, no cohesion, it's the shear type, and a small tensile strength gives you the tear type, so it gives a nice overview of what you can expect. And here they show it with the Mohr circles in those areas A, B and C of the previous picture. I already put this on Blackboard, so you can just look at those pictures. If you like, I can also put this publication on Blackboard, because for me it's always a nice introduction in what is actually happening, because they have many pictures of failing mechanism. Well, then they show what happens under different angles. This is sand under 30 degrees, dry sand. So they start with 30 degrees, and it looks a little bit like it's almost the flow mechanism, but it's not. You have discrete shear planes, so the material is really shearing. Well, if you make the angle bigger, 45 degrees, you can see you get much more failure lines, visible failure lines. You have to consider that the fact that you don't see something doesn't mean it's not there, because in sand it's always difficult to determine did it shear or not. 60 degrees, 75 degrees, and then they have 90 degrees. Here you can see very clearly the area where the material is shearing. Then they also have such a series for plastic loam. You can see at a very small angle, you get a crack here. And one of the reasons is that the normal stresses are not high enough if the angle is too small. 45 degrees, we still see a crack here, but you see the material is flowing over the blade as a continuous material. 60 degrees, we don't see the crack anymore, so you get a nice continuous flow. And in fact, if you don't want continuous flow, one of the things you can do is reduce your blade angle, because you will get that crack sooner. Yeah, so you could say, if I have a bigger angle, the bending is more, so I should get the crack, but it's all a matter of the ratio between different stresses. 75 degrees, and I found that this picture in their publication was upside down, but nobody noticed. But when I made the slides, I thought something is wrong, so I just flipped the picture. This is a 90 degree blade, and this is the material. Okay, now if we look at the cutting processes, and we want to go further with theory, first we have to talk about some definitions. So this is the material. We have a blade under an angle alpha. Here we have the angle beta, just like with passive and active soil failure. The blade has a height HB. You could also define a blade length. It's a matter of definition, but I use the height of the blade. And here you have the thick, we call it the thickness of the layer cut. Yeah, you could call it a height, but I call it a thickness. I'm cutting a certain layer. The edge of the blade we call point A. Then where the shear plane comes to the surface we call point B. And the top of the blade we call point C. Then you have a certain cutting velocity, which is in the positive direction. And we have two forces, horizontal force and vertical force. You can define many more forces, but finally you need two forces under 90 degrees, and so those are the forces. So those are the horizontal and the vertical force, and what you can see is that the vertical force, the positive direction, is downwards. So if we find a positive vertical force, it means the force is downwards, so it's pulling the blade into the soil, and that's what happens in certain cases. The types we saw, I added one type, and that's the curling type, because we found that if you have a very thin layer of material with rather high adhesion, but it could also happen under other circumstances, then the normal force in the shear plane is not strong enough to push the material all the way over the blade, because the adhesive force is holding it up, and it will either start curling or it will crack, it will bend, buckle, whatever you want to call it. In offshore drilling they call it balling of the chip. So in fact this also happens when you are drilling at 5 or 10 kilometers for oil. And there, the thickness that you are cutting is like 0.2 millimeters, so that explains why they have this problem, because it's a very thin layer. So, thin layers, high adhesion in some way, gives you a curling type, and that's also what happens in steel cutting. Then, if the layer is thicker, and it's always a combination of a thicker layer of material, the adhesion is a little bit less, and the force in the shear plane is big enough to push the material all the way over the blade. I always compare it with cheese cutting. If you have very young cheese, it will stick to the blade and it will crack. If you have medium cheese, it will nicely flow over the blade. And if you have very old cheese, which I prefer, by the way, you will get a crack. Yeah, so this is the tear type with those tensile failures. And then this is what happens in sand. And like sand didn't have cohesion and tensile strength, and you get all those discrete shear planes. In sand, by the way, the distance between the shear planes, we found from many tests in the laboratory, it's like 1 to 2 centimeters. It depends on the sand, of course, but the magnitude is 1 to 2 centimeters. Now, cutting forces. The first step is a generic equation which is valid for all types of material. And that means in the picture we need to have all the forces that could occur. It doesn't mean they will occur, but they could occur. So which forces do we have? First of all, the I. The I stands for inertial force. The inertial force is the force because the material has to accelerate. And although I said there is no acceleration, there is no acceleration of this lump of material, but before a particle passes the shear plane, it has no velocity at all. After it passes the shear plane, it has a velocity related to the velocity of the blade. Yeah? So it must have accelerated. So there is an acceleration force. And this acceleration force, in fact, is the same force that you get when you have the hose of a fire truck and you open it and you feel that impulse force pushing you back. With the same equation, you can calculate this inertial force. So that's the first force. Secondly, the cohesive force. If the material has a shear strength, a cohesion, then you just multiply that cohesion by the cross-section of the shear plane and you find your cohesive force. Then we always have a normal force, and if you have an angle of internal friction, you get a shear force. So that's the N1 and the S1. And if you combine the two, you get the K1. So the K1 is not an extra force, it's the sum of N1 and S1. Yeah? It's just the factorial sum of the two. So those are the forces. Then, in many soils, underwater, because dredging occurs underwater, there could be pore pressures. And if the pore pressures are not equal to the hydrostatic pressure, you either get an overpressure or an underpressure. We always talk about underpressures, and this underpressure will also result in a force on the shear plane. So that's the W. The W stands for water, so it's the water pore pressure force. Then we have the G, which is the weight of this lump of soil. And on the blade, you get the A, which is equivalent to the C, but now it's the adhesion, the adhesive force, which is the external shear strength of the material. So that's the A. Very weak clay usually has an adhesion which is almost equal to the cohesion. It can never be bigger, but it could be equal. If you have very dry clay, but then we talk very weak clay, we talk about, let's say, 1 to 20 kPa, then it's relatively weak. And the clay that you used to play with when you were little at home would be in that range. It's weak clay, and I think also the clay they use for pottery would be somewhere in that range. But you can also have very hard clay, like 400 kPa shear strength, and that's very dry. And then usually on the outside, if you would touch it, you would hardly feel any adhesion. And in fact, if I would even have harder clay, then you have a transition between clay and certain types of rock. Yeah, rock doesn't have adhesion at all. So the ratio between the adhesion and the cohesion is decreasing with increasing shear strength. Then you also have the normal force and the shear force under an angle delta. Delta is the angle of external friction. So we had the internal friction, here we have the external friction, and this external friction can never be bigger than the internal friction. Usually it's about 2/3 of the internal friction. Yeah, so if you don't have any value, just take 2/3 and that will work. And we have the pore pressures, the W. So those are the pressures. Then if you look at the forces on the blade, because here we looked at the forces on the soil. Well, here the forces are exactly the same, but in opposite direction. Yeah? Action is reaction. So you should always look carefully, am I looking at the forces on the blade or am I looking at the forces on the soil, because there's just a plus minus difference. Now, there's one more thing which we normally don't use, but in the curling type, if you would have a curling type of process, you need this, and that's the moments. Well, most of the forces, they are parallel either to the shear plane or to the blade, and that means they will not result in a moment around the edge of the blade. That was point A, I think. But which forces result in a moment? Well, on the shear plane you have the N1 and the W1. We assume they are at the same point of action, so they have the same radius. So this will cause a moment, and on the blade you have the normal force and the pore pressure force. We also assume they are at the same point of action, and this is the radius. So basically, I can create three conditions out of this. I have my equilibrium of horizontal forces, vertical forces, and moments. And with those three, I can solve most problems. We always have the beta, which is left in the equations. And for the beta, we do roughly the same as with passive and active soil failure. But the principle is that we say nature is lazy. So nature wants to do this with a minimum of energy, which we call the minimum energy principle. Well, what is energy in such a cutting process? Energy is the horizontal force times the cutting velocity. The vertical force is perpendicular to the velocity, so it does not contribute to your power, to your energy, which is consumed. So if you say, okay, so horizontal force times velocity is the cutting power, and I want to minimize the cutting power, it means I have to find the beta where the horizontal force is at the minimum. And that's the principle we use to find the correct beta. In this case, you cannot solve it analytically. You have to solve it numerically. And that has to do with the nature of many of the equations, which are non-linear and sometimes implicit, and that just means you cannot solve it directly. You need a computer to solve it, in most cases. What is the solution? So I'm not going to give you all the equations and how I solve it. This is the solution. So if I have this horizontal and vertical equilibrium and I solve it, then for the K2, which was the force on the blade, I find this equation. And then once I know the K2, I can calculate the horizontal and vertical force on the blade. So that's the bottom two equations. But if we look at the equation, then we can see something. We can see that each force is independent in the equation. And that's very nice. So there's no cross multiplying or anything. Each force is independently in the equation. So here we have the pore pressures on the blade, pore pressures on the shear plane, the weight, the inertial force, cohesive force, and adhesive force. Well, the fact that they are independent in the equation is very nice, because now we can say, okay, in a certain type of soil, we can delete a number of forces if they are not applicable for that type of soil, and what's left is the equation for that type of soil. So we will start with dry sand. If I have dry sand, I will not have the W2 and the W1, so they are zero. Is the G important? Yes, because there are hardly any other forces, so I need the weight of the soil. So the G is important. Is the I important? At high cutting velocities it is, at low cutting velocities it's not. If you say, okay, what's the difference between 1 meter per second and 10 meters per second? That's a factor 100, because in the I, the velocity is squared. So probably at 10 meters per second it's relevant, but at 1 meter per second, probably I can neglect it. So it depends on how fast I'm cutting. Do I have a C and an A, cohesion and adhesion? Not in sand. Sand doesn't have cohesion and adhesion. So in dry sand, only the G and the I are left. That's it. Wet sand, well, we have water in the pores, so we will have those pore pressures. And those pore pressures can be rather big. That means I can neglect the weight. It doesn't play a role. The inertial force at very high cutting speeds, but not at normal cutting speeds, so normally I will also neglect the I. The C and the A, it's still sand, so I don't have cohesion and adhesion, so I can neglect them. Two other things I should look at, the delta and the phi. Sand has internal and external friction, so they have a value. Yeah, so I have to take them into account. Then clay. Well, clay doesn't have those pore pressures. The weight can be neglected. Inertial force can be neglected. But clay has cohesion and adhesion. But clay, in our case, and I will explain next week, doesn't have a phi and a delta. You don't have internal and external friction at very high velocities. At very low speed, like 100 years, clay could have internal friction. We call it the phi is zero concept, but I will explain that next week. So we have the C and the A term, and those two are zero. Well, it makes the equations more simple. Then the last one is rock. If we look at rock, we don't have those pore pressures under normal conditions, at atmospheric conditions. G is neglectable, I is neglectable. Rock has shear strength, so we have to take the shear strength into account. Rock doesn't have adhesion on the outside, but rock has internal and external friction, so we have to take those into account. So here you have one equation, and depending on the type of soil, you can delete a number of terms or variables, and that way you can get an equation for each type of soil. Okay, that's it for today, and then tomorrow we will continue.